Hello, everybody, and welcome to PPG World Service. This is Louise Stapleton-Frappell, and I'm talking to you from sunny Spain. It's Sunday, the 6th of March, 2016, and today I'm actually joined by Rebecca King, who will be making sure that everything runs nice and smoothly for us, so a very big thank you to Rebecca. Unfortunately, my co-host Nikki Tudge can't be with us today as she's away on business, but we'll catch up with her on the next show. And I'm very sorry, we haven't got our force-free jingle, and as I can't sing quite as well as Nikki, I'm definitely not going to sing it for you. We've got three amazing guests lined up who've all agreed to take time out of their busy schedules in order to join us on this show. So I'm going to go ahead actually and introduce the first guest, and it's Dr. Michelle Duda. And Dr. Duda is a senior board certified behavior analyst, and we're going to be discussing her presentation at PPG's Force Free Summit, which was called Stop Barking Up the Wrong Tree, How to Implement Best Practices for Coaching. And we're also going to be chatting about her role as founder and president of Implementation Scientists LLC. Now, Dr. Duda, or Michelle, is a senior level board certified behavior analyst, and she's the founding president of the coaching and research firm Implementation Scientists. She's over 15 years of experience investigating and conducting practical applications of best practices associated with behavioral interventions to improve outcomes for consumers. She's served as a consultant, a researcher, as trainer, professor. She's a published author specializing in education, early intervention, applied behavior analysis, health autism, mental health, substance abuse. Dr. Duda's got extensive experience working in applied settings and measuring the implementation of evidence-based programs, practices, and system change initiatives. So I would like to say, Michelle, welcome to the show.
Hello. Thank you for that wonderful introduction and for the opportunity to be here today.
Oh, you're more than welcome. Thank you so much for joining us, because I know it's a Sunday afternoon. Is it Mother's Day actually in America? Because it's Mother's Day over in the UK today.
Oh, no. Mother's Day is usually it's in May in the US.
Oh, okay. So it's a different date.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was going to say, because Gabrielle actually said to me it was Mother's Day, and I thought, well, it's not here in Spain, but it obviously is in the UK. So.
Great.
Yeah, so we obviously all have different days of the year for Mother's Day.
That's right.
How strange. Well, I'm going to go ahead anyway and ask the first question. And basically, we'd absolutely love to hear about your role as founder and president of Implementation Scientists. And can you tell us a little bit about the company, please?
Sure. So about 2 years ago, I officially launched Implementation Scientists. And the purpose is really built on the foundation of coaching, which relates to the presentation that I was able to share with folks in November. But really the notion of coaching is to give skills away and to build capacity of other individuals that you're supporting. And by building capacity, I'm referring to the knowledge, skills, and abilities to deliver programs, best practices, systems change initiatives to ultimately impact the consumers. And as you heard, or as you shared from the introduction, I've had the wonderful opportunity of working across human services and working across very diverse contexts. So everything from working in the healthcare sector and working in hospital settings in Canada to working with scaling up best practices in education across the U.S. So the need that really emerged, and I'm sure folks joining us today have experienced this, is that in 2016, we're at a really great place that we know what strategies, what interventions work. And this whole notion of evidence-based practice movement has really taken hold across the multiple sectors. Where the challenge comes in is that systems aren't designed to support whoever's delivering the intervention. So whether the intervention is a behavior support plan, whether the intervention is training techniques, or whether the intervention is, as I mentioned, an entire systems change strategy. So there's a science behind how to support the people and how to create a system to deliver the ultimate outcome. So what I've had the like I said, honor of working with multiple organizations across Canada and the U.S. primarily, but to really help give those skills, teach folks some of the tools in order to ultimately make sure that clients or consumers can benefit from these many great scientific practices that we have access to.
Wow, how amazing. That sounds really interesting, actually. You've mentioned Canada a couple of times. Are you from Canada, or?
Yeah, I am, actually. So,
I'm Canadian.
I moved to the U.S. for graduate school because, actually, it's kind of interesting to me. At the time when I knew I wanted to pursue graduate work, there were no programs in Canada for behavior analysis, and that was really my passion. So so that's what actually brought me to the U.S. over 15 years ago, was to continue my study in applied behavior analysis and be able to participate I consider myself a researcher and practitioner, so I've been engaged in applied research for the whole time I've been in the U.S.
Okay, and what's the situation now? You said that's 15 years ago, so what's the situation now in Canada, re-applied behavior analysis? Has it changed from then?
Absolutely. So before in Canada, I could speak in the autism sector in particular, when families needed services, they would send their child or the family and the child to the U.S. for usually discrete trial training or different applied behavior analysis methodology because they didn't have the training and capacity in Canada or the certification. So when I got my certification as a board certified behavior analyst, I was one of six in all of Canada, which really was a gap in the country. Now there's training programs. They're still working towards in-house certification, but there's university programs that now can support behavior analysts. I don't know what the number exactly is in Canada. If folks are looking for a behavior analyst in Canada, if you go to BACB.com, which is the governing board, you'll be able to find a provider in that area. So it's really evolved in terms of, one, now there's the people with the skills and certification to deliver a huge need and help fill a huge gap in Canada. And then, two, for the autism sector, the government started supporting early childhood services first. So what's really amazing, and I hope one day U.S. Adopts the model, is that they allow families to select whatever evidence-based program they feel most comfortable with. And the government will support it, and by support I mean provide funding for it. And I'm not sure if it's full funding or part of it, but just to really make sure that whatever they choose has an evidence base to it. And where my interest is not only making sure that people select things with an evidence base, but that they also have the skills or the capacity to be able to use those strategies that are evidence-based.
Wow, that's great, actually. That's good to hear as well that it has actually evolved. You surprised me when you said that at one point there were only six applied behavior analysis in Canada. That's astounding.
Yeah.
Absolutely, yep. Astounding, and that you had to travel to America. Wow,
yep.
That has surprised me. Yeah, I'm glad that you're saying that things have moved on.
For
And
sure.
Yeah, that sounds really interesting, actually, the fact that they're using the, obviously, the evidence-based programs, but also providing funding for it as well. So that giving the people the choice, that's unusual that the parents are actually given the choice as well, no?
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I think is so amazing and so empowering. And I think it really helps increase the accountability of providers. So again, creating that demand for training and formal training to be able to deliver appropriate interventions. Because unfortunately what happens is, you know, and I'm someone who believes that people always have the best intentions, but when we're, you know, maybe we're, as a professional, if we're using practices that maybe don't have an evidence base, or we're not sure of the full kind of package, because rarely is a program just one step, we could actually be causing harm to our clients, or families might invest in something that they feel is really gonna make a difference, and it's untested, or you know, it may not be what they're actually looking for, or what their child, or you know, either or their human or their fur child may actually need.
Yeah, I was going to say that actually, because everything that you're talking about, in a way, it's applicable as well to our dogs, our cats, you know, our companions. How much work have you actually done? Within the pet care industry, do you find that it's quite easy, the crossover of the knowledge? You know, how have you found it? How much of a focus have you got in the pet industry?
Yeah, so I have less focus in the pet industry, other than my dogs. My participant in a few national presentations for clicker training. So the opportunity to really see in the Association for Behavior Analysis and then the governing body of Applied Behavior and Analysts International, they actually several years back started a special interest group for animals. And the conferences always have a huge thread of animals, and not in the traditional, you know, where behavior therapy was really founded, with, you know, rats and pigeons and learning about different patterns of behaviors and punishment and, you know, more proactive techniques and that kind of thing. But really to see how can we really embrace and support animals in a more positive, proactive, animal-centered way. So it's fascinating to see sessions like, you know, how behavior analysis is used to train animals at a zoo in order to receive different medical treatments and participate in exams in a safe way for both the animal and for the person, and to see how animals are used as a service for individuals, whether it's for individuals with autism, whether it's supporting military families and post-traumatic stress disorder. So how do you use these behavioral techniques and supports for teaching the animal the skills? And as folks on this call or on this show know, that it's really the human-animal relationship. So it's really that dyad that you're looking at when you're looking at how do you support the animals. So the neat thing is that the science is the science. So the science of behavior and the science of implementation all follow the same components. It's almost like, you know, if you compare it to physics. So they follow the same governing rules, but it could be applied to the different settings. So I like to think about it, here's where the art and the science come together. So we know the science, the art is how you apply it, and the application is where, you know, I've, you know, had a enjoyable career thus far that I really think is more hobby, that I've been able to work in all these very different sectors and different domains across the service industry without having to be an expert in, you know, spinal cord injuries, for example, which was one of the projects I worked in. So I always have been fortunate to partner with great people that have the skills in that domain, but I can partner with them around the science of behavior and the science of implementation.
Absolutely, that's so true, actually, what you just said. You know, obviously the science, it does, the science doesn't, is not species specific, and therefore there is it's not just a crossover, it's totally applicable, and everything you said as well about, you know, the choice, and I think that was it's fascinating, actually, because the big thing with dog training, and I'm going to say behavior consultations, etc., I think as well, is giving the people, giving the owners some mm-hmm. choice as to, as long as we're using positive methods, you know, let's think about this. Let's give the animals some choice. Let's give the people some choice. Let them select the program that they can work with, because if we implement a program that actually they're not going to follow, we're not doing anybody any favors, are we?
Exactly, exactly. I love that you emphasize that point. And I think that by paying attention to that and really giving folks the opportunity choice really is empowering, I think, to show here's what's possible. But it's also really taking on a strengths-based approach. So it's understanding what are the individuals, or you know, the pet and the human capacity to use particular strategies, to be able to, you know, manage, you know, what worked really well when we were, you know, working with our trainer and other dogs at the facility, and then when we're at home, it's completely different. So how do we help, you know, set people up for success, you know, and I think that's one of our roles as professionals, that, you know, we're in service to our clients. So how do we make sure that they're empowered, they have the skills that they need, and they have some, you know, access to different strategies that will work. And ultimately, you know, they're the expert with their pet. So how do we build upon that expertise as well?
Yes, definitely, that's right. Anyway, I'm going to, I took you totally off track, and I said that would happen, so I'm going to get back to the question that I actually planned, so I do apologize. Yes, but the thing is, when you say something that is so interesting, obviously, you know, we do want to follow through with that, and I think what you've said, what you just said as well about, you know, the strength-based approach, and It's empowering the person, and the person or the animal. I think that is really important. So I'm glad you said that. Anyway, from 2007 to 2014, you were an associate director of the National Implementation Research Network. Can you tell me a little bit about it? What's that? The National Implementation Research Network.
Yeah, great question. So the National Implementation Research Network. And if folks are interested in learning more about it, if you just Google NIRN, it'll take you to the website, and there's tons of great resources around implementation science-based strategies. So the network originally started about 2005 here in Tampa, Florida, at the University of South Florida, and it was a group of researchers that really came together around the frustration that time and time again, whether it's a federal initiative, whether it's a state initiative, that these great programs and great evidence-based practices were starting to be developed and really emerge as, you know, of course we would use evidence-based practices in our work, but there was still a gap with actually seeing improvements for consumers or for clients. And the question was, how come in some circumstances things work really well. And the same program applied with a different group or in a different country doesn't work so well. So there's a monograph that was developed that was an intensive review of the literature that looked at everything from, you know, what are the systems needed to consistently build roads across the country, to, you know, what are great structures needed in place for particular mental health programs in Norway, to, you know, everything in between. And we did several interviews with these experts to say, well, what are those things that work? Like, there has to be something common across these different sectors. You know, we even looked at banking and business. What are those things that work, and what are the things that don't work so well, so that when we're developing these best programs and best practices, we can make sure that whoever is delivering the intervention, and intervention I'm using very broadly, you know, has the skills to do so. And we came up with this, you know, list, and there was more evidence, as you can imagine, for things that didn't work so well. And we had less evidence about what worked really well. So when we interviewed colleagues across the globe, a lot of the times we'd hear, when you figure that out, let us know. So we evolved from kind of all these lists of what works, small list, what doesn't work, huge list, and then develop frameworks around that. And so our little research team started at the University of South Florida, and then in 2008 we were all offered positions at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, you know, most of us were able to physically move to North Carolina. Some of us stayed in Florida, and we just kept evolving our understanding of these frameworks. So moving from those lists to the making sense, continued evolving the frameworks and helping create concrete tools and strategies that others could use and others can learn about as we worked across different government grants. So and our experience really came in multiple ways. So whether it was a local mental health agency that we'd have the opportunity to really try to support, or large scaling up initiative, which is still going on, for how to scale up best practices in education, to you know, me having the opportunity to go back home to Canada and work with three provinces in helping in the health sector. And I'm actually doing some work currently in Ontario and continuing some of my work that I started with the National Implementation Research Network with the mental health sector. And we've had the opportunity to create more alignment in terms of personnel and support from what I like to think of from the community level to the ministry, and to support youth struggling with mental health and addiction across it. So it's a really great group that not only was developed to understand and teach and coach and support others around implementation science, but another big part of the NIRN, or the National Implementation Research Network, is to really have the opportunity to start having global conversations and come up with global, you know, agreed upon definitions on implementation science and the evolution of implementation science as a field. So in 2011, we actually had the first global implementation conference in Washington, D.C. And for folks that are interested in learning more about this field, as a launching point from 2011 conference, there are now implementation hubs that are across the globe that folks that have an interest and have a stake in really helping expand and evolve the field are more organized. So it's really, really grown. So moving from, you know, creating another silo and another separate field, it's really about the science is the science, and, you know, whether I'm in Sweden or Spain or Canada or the U.S., it's still the same thing. So how do we build this common language, common understanding, so we could really use what we know from the science to support everyone we serve?
Wow, that's absolutely fascinating. And I tell you, before we actually continue, obviously we're talking about implementation science. If anybody's still slightly unsure as to what it means, can you give us a little bit of an overview? Like, what exactly is implementation science? What does it refer to?
That's an excellent question. So implementation science is really the systematic variables and the conditions needed to actually implement or use a program with known dimensions. So we need to know what the best practices or the core components of a program is in order to deliver it. And implementation science is really the delivery system or support system for people to be able to actually deliver that service. And kind of two ways I like to think about it in a really shortcut way. So I think about implementation science as a tablet or your iPhone, and I think of the different programs, practices, strategies as the different apps. So if we have the right operating system and we have the device, our apps will work. And it almost doesn't matter what type of app or application it is. It needs that device to be able to run. So when we think about the work that we do, you know, we're usually using more than one program or more than one strategy, but we need a common system, operating system, to make sure that we could predictably deliver these different strategies or different programs as intended. The other kind of big idea around thinking about what is this implementation science stuff, I like to think about it as the implementation driver triangle, which is one of our frameworks that I can share resources to after the call or after our discussion, but to really think about what is it that we want people to do in order to say, yeah, we're using this program or strategy as intended. And we can think about it in kind of two different ways. So we can think about the people using the intervention as the folks that were training and their pet, or we can think about it as if I'm an organization and I'm training trainers to deliver these supports, what is it that I want them to do? So we always need to have kind of a clear sense of what are those core skills or core components. And then in order to do that, it's helpful to think about it as a system. So if we know what it is people should be doing, then it's important for us to think about how do we honor where they're at, as we talked about, and build upon their skills, and really start systematically ensuring that, you know, they have the training and the coaching they need in order to be successful at delivering, you know, the it that we talked about. The next arm to think about is what are the organization or system things that we need to do. So if we're talking about the human-animal dyad, what are the things that they need to change at home? So what do they need to change things in the environment? Do they need to create a schedule? Do they need to, you know, refine kind of their daily schedule or routines in order to do the work? So thinking about the organization system side in that sense could be the home setting. But it's all in service to being more successful at delivering that it. If we're talking about if I'm responsible for training and coaching a cadre of trainers, what are the things that my organization needs to do to ensure that folks have the time that they need in order to learn the new strategies? What are the things that people need maybe taken off their plate so they can focus on, you know, this new strategy that they're utilizing? So that's the kind of organization systems arm. And then the last piece is leadership. So one of the things that, you know, I'm a true proponent of is really building and empowering people to be able to use these strategies as intended, but also really to build leadership in order to sustain these things and to sustain whether it's the strategies used, and people can then translate that or generalize that to home or different contexts, or if we're thinking about, you know, a broader system or a broader organization like a large mental health institution, how do we make sure that, you know, we're preparing for the next generation and sustaining what works so that eventually all of our clients have access to these same strategies and same supports?
Right, and so just going back over that then, you're basically saying that obviously we look at the core components of effective implementation, we break it down into stages, we empower basically the client or the person or even the animal. And we coach. I think I know your presentation at the Force Free Summit last year in Tampa, Florida, it was called Stop Barking Up the Wrong Tree, and it was how to implement best practices for coaching. So there's obviously quite a big emphasis on the coaching. What were the learning objectives actually of your presentation?
Yeah, I had actually three broader learning objectives. So one, I really wanted to highlight the importance of coaching and unpack some of the misconceptions on what coaching is and what does it actually look like in practice and why, and hopefully provide some compelling rationales with the science and with some experience for why, if we're really serious about ensuring that, you know, whoever we're training has the skills and ability to sustain it, that we always include a coaching component. So I wanted to talk about the rationales of why coaching is important. I wanted to become more concrete and help folks walk away with at least two core skills that good coaches have, and had really talked about and had a really fun video that talked about the difference between, you know, does it matter if you're a basketball coach and supporting someone trying to sing the national anthem, or if you're a coach in a very complex setting, what are those skills that good coaches need to have? Because that's something that we're not all born with. And then to really help people walk away with a few strategies and concrete tools that they could use to ensure that how they can extend training through coaching, and what are some tools to really clarify what is it that we want people to do, and then to kind of backwards map that and think about, well, how do we train for those skills and how do we enhance the training through coaching for those targeted skills?
Right, so obviously you brought up a good point there, the difference between coaching and training. Lots of people, you know, they call themselves dog trainers. Other people say that they teach, and other people say that they coach. Can you explain a little bit about the difference? What's the difference between coaching and training and teaching?
Great questions, and you know, it's I like that you brought that up, because one of the things that we did spend some time with was really looking at the different terminology used for thinking about, you know, training, coaching, consulting, mentoring, all these words, you know, and terms came up that have very different meaning. Some differences really comparing training and coaching. I like to think about coaching as really focused on refining some of those skills that someone would have learned in a training session. So training typically is more about, you know, showing how to do something, telling people here's what to do, here's what it looks like. You know, maybe there'll be a demonstration for how it's done, and it's usually done in a group setting. Coaching, in instructional coaching, most times is done on a one-to-one basis, and is really more about reflecting with the individual that you're coaching on, you know, understanding what are some of the challenges that they're experiencing. You know, when they take it home, it's completely different. So being able to problem solve and empower, and coaching also is really, or my approach to coaching is really helping push people a little bit outside of their out of their comfort zone in applying new and fragile skills, but to always be that safety net that, you know, I'm right there. If things don't go quite as planned, and life doesn't go quite as planned most of the time, so how can you be there for that just-in-time support and to really contextualize? The other kind of nuance that I see between training and coaching is that coaching, I think you develop a greater depth of a relationship than in a typical training context. So again, you really get to know, your client or your coachee on a very different level than if you're training them, so that you can pay attention to how do I continue empowering them, how do I continue refining their skills, how do I, you know, really individualize or customize, you know, what was learned in the training to their very specific needs.
Thank you, Michelle. That was a great explanation. Really good. Thank you. I'm sure that has cleared it up for a lot of people, because there is a lot of confusion for people, you know, with these different terms, and that does make it really clear. So thank you. I'm going to have to say, actually, we've more or less run out of time. In fact, as you said, things don't often go to plan, and we've probably actually run over slightly. But never mind. That's so fascinating to talk to you. I could actually keep asking you questions all day. If somebody would like to get in touch with you to learn more, how can they do that, Michelle?
Great question. Well, I definitely would love people to connect with me. So two ways. You could go to my website, which is www.behaviorhappens.com, and whether you spell behavior with a U or not, it'll both take you there, or you could reach me at behaviorhappens@gmail.com. And again, I would love to, you know, answer any questions folks might have about coaching, to share specific tools and strategies. I think that, you know, coaching is often overlooked and so critical for ensuring that we actually, you know, take our support and our service to our clients, human and animals, to the next level. So it's an area I'm definitely passionate about and would love to share. So thank you for this opportunity, and hope to hear from folks in the near future.
Thank you so much, and I'm sure you will. And I love that you said behavior with a U or without a U.
It's the Canadian in me. I had to, you know, respect both spellings.
Exactly, and the English, obviously, we English, you know, we have the U. So
yeah. Spell check always gets me on that.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, well, thank you so much, Michelle. Hope you have a wonderful rest of your day.
Great.
And, And thank you for saying that, you know, people can get in touch with you to learn more, because there is so much more to learn. So thank you.
Great. Thanks so much, and have a great rest of the day.
Thank you, Michelle.
Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, so we're actually going to crack on, because we're running a little bit behind schedule, and I'm going to introduce our next guest. And our next guest is Amy Martin, and we're going to be talking to Amy about her article in it was last January's edition of Barks from the Guild, actually, and it was called A Judgement Free Zone, as well as her involvement with Family Paws, Parent Education, and Doggone Safe. And Amy's studied animal welfare, she's studied applied behavior analysis, animal husbandry, animal enrichment for nearly 20 years, including she had a decade at a top-rated Association of Zoos and Aquariums accredited zoo. She was an institutional representative for various critically endangered species survival plans and president of the New Orleans chapter of the American Association of Zookeepers. Her expertise actually lies in exotic and domestic animal handling, animal training, animal enrichment, and animal medicine, so a big range of things there. And she's got extensive experience with hurricane and emergency planning and preparation for humans and animals. So, Amy, hello and welcome to the show.
Hi, Louise, and hi, everyone out there.
And how are you, Amy? Hope you're feeling well today.
I am. I'm good. It's been a challenging week, but I'm so happy and excited to be here with everybody. So thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you for taking time out of your schedule to come on and talk to us. Now, I've just mentioned all the different things that you do. What are some of the species that you've actually had the opportunity to work with?
Well, it's funny you mentioned all that, and I thought, oh, I forgot about that. You were going into the intro. Over the years, it's actually been a diverse number of species. I first began rehabilitating and managing wildlife, native wildlife, for education programs. That was when I was in college at LSU, way back in the mid-90s. Then I worked with large and small domestics at LSU Vet School. And after those chapters, I moved to New Orleans and began my animal training and husbandry career at Audubon Nature Institute. That's actually where I work primarily with exotic species, panthera, exotic cats, corvids, citicines, marsupials, bears, giraffe, venomous snakes. I love venomous snakes. Insects, primates, crocs, komodos, giant tortoises, the first clones. That was really fun. And lots of other species survival plan animals. So it was a lot of fun.
Oh, wow. And which experience actually stood out the most for you, and for what reason?
Well, that's a tough question, because each one of the species that I mentioned is very unique and holds a special place in my heart. They've all taught me invaluable lessons, but I guess if I had to pick one, it would be my first professional experience with force-free training. And the gentle giants who actually taught me were 500-pound tortoises. They're called the Aldabra tortoises. So it was those.
Oh, wow. That is absolutely fascinating. Not many people are able to say that their first experience with force-free training was with a giant tortoise.
That was normal. But at the time, there wasn't a lot of force-free going on. That was in 2000, and there was no formal training program. But I wanted to start one with our Aldabras. They were really unique and really special, and I knew that they were not being treated the way that they needed to be. So at the time, everything in our husbandry, which is managing and breeding, was wrestling and wrangling. The men thought the idea of asking the tortoises to do anything was insane. So our female vet and I did the training silently behind the scenes, and then we produced incredible tangible results. We gained the trust of the Aldabras. They learned to trust people for the first time. Then we trained them for husbandry and public purposes. We conditioned them to give blood voluntarily. And then once the managers saw that our techniques were safer and more effective, they were all on board. So it wasn't an easy chapter in force-free training, but it was all worth it in the end. I published a paper about how we did it, and now other zoos and aquariums all over the world have learned from our work and applied it to their reptile programs. But in the end, it was the Aldabras that taught all of us. They're really amazing, amazing species.
Oh, wow, that is absolutely fascinating. I'm just looking actually at my screen and I've got a little picture of you there.
Yes, that's
Yeah.
feldspar.
Sorry, that's.
That's feldspar. His name is feldspar. He was 70 years old at the time, which is actually middle age.
Oh, wow. Well, so if that's middle age, what's the average lifespan?
Well, if they're really healthy, like Magma, the other male, when I left, he was 90, so now he's pushing 100, but he's still very healthy. That has a lot to do with husbandry and a lot of different factors, but if they're really healthy, they'll get to be about 150.
Wow.
Yeah,
So
I was like a baby
they,
training them. They're like this
yeah.
young whippersnapper.
So they're definitely have going to have previously experienced a lot of different training techniques, let's say.
Oh
Like
yes.
how amazing actually that, you know, things have turned around and are now as they should be. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So absolutely fascinating. I'd love to talk to you though about your article in last year's January edition of Barts, which was A Judgement Free Zone. You talked about the importance of education, compassion, support, and non-judgmental guidance. Now, what inspired you to write that article? Because you know, we're going from giant we're going from these beautiful giant creatures to you know, talking about supporting non-judgmental guidance. And you know, where did the article come from? What inspired you to write it?
That's a great question. And it does seem like a huge leap, but it's actually not. But because what inspired me are the not only the families with whom I consult, but it's actually the interns and the volunteers that I taught and mentored over the years at Audubon. And it's the people who have taught and mentored me. Over the years, I just started to notice that we're so quick to judge each other, to blame, to judge an animal, to blame the animal. Great example with the tortoises, but the interns and the volunteers that I worked with, that was not really an option because that's not where they were in the learning process. So I learned that when the only thing that judging and blaming does is creates a barrier and a separation between ourselves and the object of our judgment or condemnation. It builds resistance instead of building trust. And not one of my mentors ever made me feel guilty or foolish for not knowing something or for not doing it or for doing it incorrectly. They always taught with compassion, with patience, and understanding of where I was in the learning process at the time. And so that actually carried over to how, because that was the process I was in with the tortoise. Like I said, that was my first free time of training, and everyone that taught me and mentored me never judged or blamed me. And that helped me because it carried over to how I mentored my adult volunteers and my youth interns. And then when I started my consulting business, it was natural for me to treat my clients and the public the same way. So instead of judging and blaming people for the current conditions that they found themselves in with their animals, I focused on awareness, helping them to be aware of what was happening, and compassionate education. It made a huge difference.
Yeah, and actually I can see the link now, you know, between, like you said, between the giant tortoises and, you know, moving on and talking about your clients, etc. And I'm absolutely with you. It's so important that, you know, we don't, if we just judge people, then they're more likely to walk away and we're then leaving both their, you know, the people and the animals to suffer, aren't we?
Yes,
Rather than
exactly.
working with them. Yeah. Yeah.
It again goes
So
back to building trust. Yeah, exactly.
What would you say was your take-home message from the article? What if for anybody that hasn't actually read the article, which they can do if they go onto the Pet Professional Guild website, because you can look up all the past articles in Barks and have a good read. But what was your take-home? What would you say the take-home message was?
Well, William Arthur Ward has a really great quote, and I think it sums it up beautifully. The mediocre teacher tells, the good teacher explains, and the superior teacher demonstrates. The great teacher inspires. I believe that quote wholeheartedly. Guidance, inspiration, and motivation has always been the best tool for bridging the gap in communication. It creates awareness instead of feelings of guilt or resistance to a message. Understanding and compassion and empathy leaves no room for blaming, judgment, or wrongdoing. Building relationships with any species that we're working with, whether it's human or animal, is based on trust and mutual respect. And so I guess the really big home takeaway message would be that if we want to continue to educate the masses and inspire the public and have real long-lasting positive impacts on individuals and families, we need to be inspiring, we need to be compassionate, and we need to offer non-judgmental guidance.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely, and a great message there. Now, in the article, you mentioned Family Paws Parent Education, mm-hmm. and I know that you're involved with them. Can you tell us a little bit about Family Paws and exactly what your involvement is?
Absolutely. Family Paws Parent Education, their programs demonstrate to families that there is a compassionate community that does care, that will not judge or condemn them, and that wants to help parents and families that are in need of guidance and support. Our goal in educating and supporting families through Family Paws Parent Education is not to instill fear or to place blame on families, but rather it's to help everyone become more aware of ourselves, more dog aware, more aware of our children, their behavior, and our family members in general. Awareness and positive change is the end state, but compassion, support, coaching, and guidance are where we start with Family Paws. And to answer your other question, to be involved with Family Paws, honestly, becoming a licensed educator for Family Paws Parent Education and assisting on their advisory team has been one of the greatest learning opportunities in my behavior consulting career. Guiding families as they enter a life-changing new chapter has been incredibly rewarding. It's truly an honor to serve with Family Paws. And Jennifer is not only an incredible teacher and a friend, but she's a pioneer in this field. There's no one else on earth who's as dedicated and knowledgeable about the complicated dynamics of dogs and babies and dogs and toddlers. Jennifer's compassion and non-judgmental guidance with Family Paws Parent Education is actually what drew me in and resonated with how I was approaching consulting. So if anybody's interested in getting involved, whether you're a dog trainer, a veterinarian, a behaviorist, an expecting parent, or a parent with a toddler, Family Paws Parent Education is the world's best resource for growing families with dogs. And we actually have a specialty conference coming up. The focus is creating dog-aware generations. It will be July 30th through August 1st in Cary, North Carolina. And the speakers and presenters, they're experts in their fields. They'll be sharing their tips, techniques, and experiences. And we're really excited. It's going to be a wonderful conference, just like our last one. So if anyone is interested, they can learn more about it at familypaws.com. And when you go to the website, there's actually a conference button on the upper right-hand corner of the page where they can learn more about it.
Well, thank you. Thanks for letting us know about that. You just mentioned, actually, dogs and toddlers. Now, there's a couple of programs, isn't there? There's Dogs and Storks and there's the Dogs and Toddlers program.
That's correct. And
you're a licensed presenter for both of these programs. What's the difference between the programs and what do they involve?
So the difference between that, they can learn more about it. I know we're very limited on time, so I'm not going to go into great detail, but the differences in the programs, it's really the stages. You know, we always talk about it's not just one stage. It's we're growing with the families with our program. So Dogs and Storks is, in a very brief summary, is for preparing families with dogs for life with baby, and then with toddlers, it's a life with a toddler, because we want the family to grow as the baby grows. It's a continuing process. It doesn't just end once the baby's arrived. And that's really what we try and get across to families, that it's a multiple stages, different ages. As the baby's growing, family's growing, everything is changing. So it's a constantly complex changing dynamic. And we walk the family through guided mentoring and coaching and, like we said, compassionate guidance through all these different stages in their life.
And at what stage, if somebody's got a family or they're thinking of having a family, what stage should they start looking into, you know, sort of safety with their pet dog and what's going to happen with their pet dog? Is it before, you know, they get...
It's right now. If they're thinking about adding a human baby to their fur baby family, that's a lot of people call them, it's contact us now. There's no better time than absolutely right now. We get calls from people in, you know, nearly at 40 weeks, but that's not ideal. We're always willing to help, but we'd really like to hear from people when they're just considering it. It's all about preparing and planning for the unexpected and getting families ready on multiple levels. That's why we're the experts in the field, and that's why Jen's a pioneer in this field. It's incredible. So we really, really would love people to reach out, know that there's support. We even have a dog and baby support hotline, which is 1-877-247-3407. You can reach out anytime, day or night.
Perfect. Thank you so much for that. And for people that live, I'm going to say across the world, you know, like I'm here in Europe, we've got people listening in who are from the UK. Can they take advantage of the Family Paws Parent Education Services as well?
Absolutely. We actually have presenters and we have educators all in various parts of the world right now. And you can actually find, when you go to familypaws.com, you can actually locate someone. And you can always call our baby and support hotline, and you can even email Jen at info@familypaws.com. She's always there ready to help people and guide people to a qualified professional.
Perfect, thank you. And you're also actually involved with Doggone Safe, aren't you? Now, what's your role with Doggone Safe?
Yes, I've offered Beatrice programs and dog safety awareness workshops for various youth groups over the years. I really love doing them because my focus and passion over the 20 years of educating has always been geared towards kids, and especially kids of all ages and backgrounds, different mental faculties. Just children are sponges and they want to learn, and these dog safety programs have the ability to empower kids and to create dog-aware generations. Plus, kids are really great, and they're a lot more fun to teach than adults most of the time, but what I'm always really inspired about is that children want to learn these dog safety concepts and techniques. They want to empower themselves and create a more conscious connection with their dogs at home. And these programs do that.
Excellent. Thank you. And moving on from that slightly, I think, but what your company Conscious Companion then, is it very much related to the dog safety, let's say, and dog bite prevention, or what's it about? What's your company all about?
That's a great question. A lot of people ask me that. Right now, I've actually put consulting on hold. I'm writing a couple books, and we're preparing for a big move. But when I am consulting, I work with all species of animals because that's my background. That's what I'm comfortable in. So I do everything from rats to cats, parrots to pigs, frogs to dogs. These can be good teachers, all of these animals, but there actually can be really frustrating challenges. But I do believe that when challenges arise, they can be opportunities to view life from the animal's perspective. So most of the families that I consult with, the traditional families, just the humans, pets are on the below us or on the back burner. And my intent is to bridge that gap between animals and humans. That's why my approach to animal behavior consulting with Conscious Companion focuses on every person in the home and their individual relationships with the animals, whether that's with Family Paws consulting or whether that's someone who has, you know, a guinea pig that's fearful or a rabbit, focusing on each individual person and guiding every member of the family creates success that lasts and creates a conscious connection and builds bonds that last for life. That's why I say that's we're creating life with your animal companion improves. Everything's improving.
Awesome. And you just mentioned that you've taken a little bit of a sabbatical to write. You're writing a book, did you say, or writing a couple of books?
I am. I'm writing three. But
three? Wow. Oh, my gosh. Take the easy road then, do you?
It's crazy. I sat down to write one, and then it turned into three. But we'll see what happens. Yeah, it's
oh,
one.
Oh wow.
Yeah, we'll see.
Well, I hope you'll keep us informed as to how things are going. And obviously, once your books are published, then you need to come back on and tell us all about them.
Thanks. The one I'm focused on right now is actually helping a senior cat age gracefully, and so I'm really excited about that.
Oh, how fascinating. Well, that's a definite must. You've definitely got to keep us up to date on what's happening there and let us know all about it. If people want to actually get in touch with you and learn more, is there a way that they can do that, Amy?
It is, yeah. They're welcome to visit my website at consciouscompanion.com. Yep.
Thank you very, very much, and thank you so much for coming
thank
on the
you.
Show. That's
thank
been
you so
absolutely
much. I had a great
fascinating.
time. Thank you.
It's been amazing talking to you, and I'd actually love to hear more, especially about all your work with the, you know, these zoo animals and everything.
Oh, they're amazing teachers. I would love to share what they've taught me. Thank you, Louise.
Thank you. Well, maybe what we can do is get you back on sometime, but also get you doing a webinar for the PPG and you know, giving
fun.
Us some more information. So I will be in touch, Amy.
Okay. Thanks, Louise. Have a great day. Thank you.
So you too. Thank
okay,
you very
bye.
Much, Amy. Bye-bye. So now we're going to go straight into our third interview. And we've got Gabrielle Dunne on the show. Hi, Gabrielle. How are you? Hello. Are you there, Gabrielle?
I am, yes.
Hello. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. And just so that everybody knows, Gabrielle is the regional coordinator for Doggone Safe in the UK and Ireland and Be a Tree presenter. So, Gabrielle, this is going to follow on so nicely from what we were just talking about with Amy. Can I start by asking you a little bit about your background, please?
Yes, I'm a mum, first of all, to a 9 and a 12-year-old and also another little baby on the way. So obviously from that point of view, kids' safety is paramount. I was also chair of the School Parent Teachers Association, and from that there's a number of dogs that would visit the school every day, so that was another reason at looking at the Doggone Safe programme. I am a social worker and work with child protection, also with adults and children with learning disabilities. I'm a dog trainer and I'm also a Family Paws presenter as well. And I'm on the steering committee for Doggone Safe.
Awesome. I tell you what, you know, all three of you today, everything that we've been talking about is so interrelated because obviously with Dr. Duda and Michelle, we were talking about education and, you know, the children with autism and things like that. And we've just been talking, obviously, about the Family Paws parent education programs and the Doggone Safe programs. So this is absolutely fantastic. How did you first get involved, actually, with Doggone Safe?
Well, the first time I had heard about Doggone Safe was Victoria Stillwell had been over in Ireland doing a training event and had discussed it in quite a lot of detail about Doggone Safe and the Beatrice program, as she is also a presenter. So as soon as I heard that, I just thought, oh, this is what I need to be doing, given there's such a demand for educating children and also parents around how to behave properly around dogs. So I then got involved with Joan Orr, contacted her to get further information on the program, and went from there. I then gave a very short presentation at the UK Dog Bite Prevention Conference last year, just around the Beatrice program. And then from then, Joan Orr had asked me to become the regional coordinator for Doggone Safe for the UK and Ireland.
Right, so you've mentioned a couple of times actually about a Beatrice presenter. What exactly is this? What does it mean? What does the program consist of? Can you tell us a little bit more for people that don't know?
Yeah, the Beatrice program is a program that was devised through Doggone Safe, and it's a pack that people can go online and purchase from the Doggone Safe website. It can be purchased from North America, it's from doggonesafe.com, and if you're out with that, so if you're Canada or Europe or whatever, it's doggonecrazy.ca is the website. The Beatrice program is basically, you use picture cards to teach the children about how to act safely around dogs so that it's safe both for dogs and for children. So what we would do initially is we would show the children some picture cards of the same dog but in two different scenarios. So the first dog, maybe the ears are forward, the mouth is closed, the body's quite stiff, and we would ask the kids, you know, what do you think about this dog? Then we would hold up another picture card of the same dog, but the dog would be really loose body, the mouth would be wide open, his eyes would be quite relaxed, and the kids then have to say, which dog do you think you would like to meet? And the kids would choose it out. Now, within probably about the second picture card, the kids have already worked out very, very quickly a dog that you would approach and a dog that you wouldn't approach. So they're learning all the different ways that dogs communicate with us. From that, then, the kids learn about, you know, why dogs react in certain ways. They learn that when you should approach a dog, when you shouldn't, how you should do it. So, for example, if there was a dog that had really loose body language, the kids are then taught that they have to ask their adult person that's with them, are they allowed to ask to pet the dog? They then have to ask the owner, you know, please may I pet your dog? Can you ask your dog to sit? So you're teaching the kids that if the owner, the dog owner can ask the dog to sit, that the owner has got some control of the dog. The child will then close their fist and keep it by their side, not in the dog's face. If the dog comes over to the child's fist and sniffs it at that point, that the children can then pet the dog, and we would normally recommend to pet them from the neck down, not on the head, and stroke them down towards their back. If they come up and the kids put their fist out and the dog doesn't come and sniff it, we tell the kids at that point just to leave it. So there's loads of picture cards that the kids really, really work towards. They understand what's happening because there's loads of visual stuff there for them. We also teach them that if there's a dog coming up to them and a dog's very excited, what they do is they stand and they become a tree. So they grasp their hands together. They look down at their feet as if they're roots, and they count to whatever number that they can count to. And they stay like that until either an adult comes near or the dog moves away. We also do what's called being a rock. So again, the kids, if they're down on the ground playing and a dog comes over, whether it's their own dog or a strange dog, they put their hands around the back of their neck, protecting the back of their neck and protecting the sides of their face. And again, they would remain there until an adult came by or the dog moves away. Once we've gone through all of that, we then play some games. So we would have role plays whereby the kids would play out whatever we have learned throughout the whole program. So we maybe pick three or four different kids from the audience who would come up, and they would act like a dog handler, a dog, and then children coming by. So there would be different scenarios that they would have to deal with. Then we would also do a game called Simon Says. And again, it's just reinforcing everything that they've been taught throughout the presentation. And it's about empowering kids to make good choices, not to be afraid of dogs, to understand that dogs need space and dogs can't speak to us the way they can tell us when they're uncomfortable. So it's about getting it down to the child's level so that they can learn really well.
Excellent. So in a way, it's a program, it's not only advantageous for the children, it's also advantageous for the dogs, isn't it?
Absolutely. And I know a lot of the teaching staff that have been present when I've done the programs in schools and community groups have learned so much as well that they didn't understand before.
Yeah, I think you're so right. There's a very big gap. A lot of people don't actually understand about canine communication and the way that, you know, Doggone Safe does it via the photos. It's such a good way. We've got this visual of this dog, and, you know, this dog is nice and, like you said, loose and happy and relaxed. Also, the fact that you're telling the children not to approach the dog, to let the dog approach them, you know, we are really empowering the dogs as well and giving the dogs a choice, which I think is absolutely amazing and just as it should be. Is the program just aimed at children, or does your audience vary? Like, do you go out and give presentations to adults or not? Can you hear me, Gabrielle?
Louise, it would seem that Gabrielle has gone offline.
Oh, no. Oh, that is absolutely awful. I'm glad you've let me know, Rebecca. Let's see if she can get back on. But anyway, following on from that, Doggone Safe, as well as Family Paws, is an absolutely amazing organisation. And if anybody's interested in being a Beatrice presenter or just finding out more about canine sort of safety and education, canine communication and keeping your children safe, you can actually go to the Doggone Safe website at www.doggonesafe.com, and there's so much information on there. There are some wonderful resources for both pet dog owners, for parents, for people in the community. You know, maybe you're an educator and you would like to learn more about getting a Beatrice presenter into your school, then please go to the website, because there is so much information on there. And let's see if we can get Gabrielle back on. I think she's actually disappeared, hasn't she, Rebecca? Has she disappeared for good?
She is currently logging back on.
I'm here. Okay. I'm sorry, I had to take the dog out.
You really? You went out for a walk in the middle of the interview, Gabrielle?
Good night.
Brilliant. Okay. Well, Louise. Sorry.
Hi, Louise. I'm back again. Sorry, the internet connection just dropped.
Yeah, no, I know you said you were taking the dog out. That's absolutely fine. If the dog needed to go out, Gabrielle, that's perfect. Oh, dear. What I was actually asking you before you took the dog for a walk was, do you just give presentations to school children, or does your audience vary? You know, would you go out and give presentations, for example, if you'd got a group of, let's say, I don't know, postal workers or something that wanted a presentation? Are you able to do that? Is it something that you'd consider doing, or do you think the program is, too much based just for the children? What do you think?
I think at the moment, the way that the picture cards and things are, it is geared towards children, and probably the youngest that I've done it from is probably 3 up until about 12. I think the program could definitely be adapted so that it could be used for adults. And I tend to find a lot of it is, you know, using user-friendly terminology with kids. So how you're going to teach a 5, 6-year-old is very different to how you're going to teach a 10, 11, 12-year-old. So I think the program could definitely be adapted so that it could be adults as well.
Right, perfect. So basically, when you're giving the program to a young child, let's say a child of 4, 5, 6, you do actually present it in a different way than to if you're giving the presentation to a child who's maybe sort of 9 or 10. Yes.
Absolutely. Because I think your language needs to be so much different when you're teaching a 4, 5-year-old to a 9, 10-year-old. And I'm in a lucky position in a way, as I have a 9 and a 12-year-old, and I've been doing it now for a few years. So even when I'm practicing at home, first of all, the two kids will say, well, Mama, you wouldn't actually say that to a 9, 10-year-old because they think you're speaking down to them. So say, for example, at the start, before I do the presentation, we would maybe go through, you know, what do people use dogs for? What kind of jobs can they have? So for a 4 or 5-year-old, you might say, well, you know, sometimes the police have dogs and that's to catch bad people. But obviously when you're speaking to 9, 10-year-olds, you're saying dogs can be used to catch criminals. So it's like basic wee things, but it means a lot from chatting to 4, 5 to 9, 10-year-olds. I don't tend to mix ages either. I would tend to do kind of 4 till 6, 6 till 8, 8 till 10, 10 to 12. Because you tend to find with the younger kids that they ask numerous questions, and the older ones can get a bit fed up with that if there's lots and lots of questions. So I think it's good to split the ages.
Right. And where do you give most of your presentations? Is it in schools, or how does it work? Does the school get in contact with you, or do you get in contact with organisations? How does it actually work, Gabrielle?
Most of my work has been in schools, although I have done it in different community groups like scouts, guides and things. Last year we have a touring caravan, and One of the caravan parks that we were at, there was actually a little 2.5-year-old girl that was bitten in the face by a dog. Parents were packing up the caravan, left the child to wander about. She went over to two dogs and she was bitten in the face. So rather than being proactive about it, rather than them then being a complete ban on dogs within the caravan park, what we then did was we came in and did the Doggone Safe, the Be a Tree chat to the kids in there with the parents, so that they were then educated about what's appropriate and what's not around dogs, which worked really, really well.
Excellent. I tell you what, that is so good as well. That instead of condemning either dog or person or child in any shape or form, you went in and you educated them. Absolutely as it should be.
And the one thing, Louise, that I would say is that you tend to find with children that they are like little sponges, as Amy has said before. They take absolutely everything in. And I know from one of the mums, I had done the presentation in the school, and the mum had said to me the following day, she said, "You got me into a lot of trouble last night." And I said, "Why, what happened?" And she said, "Well, I left the 2-year-old in the living room to go through to the kitchen to make a cup of tea. And her elder child, who I had been teaching the program to, had given her a row and said, 'You never leave children and dogs alone.'" So that message is going from children back to their parents, which is what we want, which is fantastic.
Absolutely, because it is so important, that message that, we do need to be actively supervising our children, and not just actually for the children's sake, I think also for the dog's sake, because obviously, children can unintentionally maybe, but, torment a dog, and dogs,
yeah.
Most of them are absolutely amazing. What they do actually put up with is quite remarkable. So I think, education is always the key. If I've actually just mentioned when you were taking your dog for a walk when you lost the signal, I mentioned that people can go to the Doggone Safe website. But if somebody was interested in becoming a Be a Tree presenter and actually wanted to find out more about it, what is the best way of them to go about that?
Well, what they can do is if they go on to the Doggone Safe website, what tends to happen is you can go on there and actually arrange a program for your school, or you can contact the presenter directly. What I tend to do, or what I find, is that people that in the UK and Ireland who are maybe interested in taking on the program and finding out a bit more would contact the regional coordinators as well and ask for information, so that they can then give them examples of what it's actually like doing it on ground level. To go out there and actually present the program.
That's good advice. So people can go onto the website and basically have a look, find out who's their regional coordinator in their sort of neck of the woods, get in touch with them, and get pointed in the right direction in that way. And so is that applicable for people just if they want to find a presenter, or is it also applicable for people that are actually interested in being a presenter?
It can be both, Louise. I've had people contact me who, are interested in the program, and then others who want to become an actual presenter. I've found within, now I'm basically on the border between the north and south of Ireland, but within the south of Ireland, there isn't as much interest in it as what there would be in Northern Ireland. But again, that's about me going out and trying to get in touch with all the schools round about Northern Ireland to advise them of the program. Because it's American-based as well, or American-Canadian-based, it's not as well known. So it's just about getting out there to try and publicise that it's a fantastic program, and that it is available. And the one thing I would say is, I can see when I go up to the school to collect my youngest daughter, and if I have the dog with me, I can pinpoint exactly what kids have had the Be a Tree presentation and what kids haven't. The kids that have had the presentation, you can see them standing with their fist out, hoping and praying that the dog will come over and sniff their fist so that they can pet the dog, because they know that if the dog doesn't, they're not allowed to pet it. Whereas you find the kids that haven't had the presentation will come over with a hand straight out to pet the head, and you have to say, "No, we don't actually do that." So there's a huge impact from this program, and if only we could get it out to all the schools, community groups, it would be amazing.
It would, and I think, to be honest, I think it should actually be a requirement on the part of, you know, the educators, the government, to get these sort of programs into schools and to be educating our youngsters about staying safe and about canine communication. It should actually be part of the curriculum, shouldn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. But sometimes you can find that it's quite difficult to get into schools. Again, it comes down to, you know, if the principal is, you know, interested in dogs and would value that. So sometimes it takes just a few times to keep at it to actually get into the school then. But once you're in, you know, the principal and the teachers and the kids see the value of the program.
Yeah, definitely. And I tell you what, how amazing as well that just standing by the school gates, you're actually able to spot which children have attended one of the presentations and which haven't, which, you know, it just shows that these programs, they do absolutely work and they have an impact, don't they?
Yeah.
Yeah. If somebody wants to learn more about canine communication, or let's call it dog body language, what resources are available to them, Gabrielle?
Well, the Doggone Safe website would be the first port of call. It's a fantastic website. There's loads of information. There's a Facebook page as well that gives out regular information around dog body language. And again, there's lots of great pictures, so it's user-friendly for kids or for adults. The other one that I particularly like is Doggone Crazy, is another kind of company of Doggone Safe. And Doggone Crazy actually have a game out, which is fantastic. It's all about dog safety. It's for kids. We've used it in schools. My own kids have used it with their friends. It's all about role playing, about being a tree, being a rock, about true and false statements in relation to dogs, Simon Says. So that is a fantastic resource.
Again, I believe that's actually available through the Doggone Safe website as well, Gabrielle. I seem to think that it's in the Doggone Safe shop, the board game, and you've got the picture books and things as well, haven't you? Are you still there, Gabrielle? I've not lost you again, have I? You've not gone out to walk your dog again, have you, Gabrielle?
Yeah, I think it's only through dog sites, I would say, would be great. No. No, I'm still here.
Okay,
just the other resources would be Family Paws again, or PPG would be fantastic.
Okay, so Family Paws.
Family Paws would be another resource that would be excellent.
Right.
Or and PPG website as well.
PPG, so the Pet Professional Guild website. Yes, absolutely. Lots of resources on there. Perfect.
Yeah.
I've actually just got a question come through for you, Gabrielle, and I am going to ask you. It's in relation to the webinar that you were going to do that we postponed, and they're wanting to know whether we've rescheduled. Now, I will say it's not rescheduled at the moment, but I'm going to ask you live on air. Can we reschedule it for a future date, please?
Absolutely. That would be great.
Awesome, thank you very much, because you know, obviously this is something, it's information that we do need to get out there, and and I would also like to wish you a very, very happy Mother's Day, because we started the show by saying, I was asking whether it was Mother's Day over in the States. Now I know it's Mother's Day for you. A massive, massive happy, happy Mother's Day, and I thank you so, so much for taking time out of your Mother's Day celebrations actually to come and talk to us.
That's fine. Thank you very much. And sorry for the loss of internet connection. We live in rural Ireland, so rural Ireland, so the internet connection isn't very good at all.
I totally understand, because where I live in Spain, it's often not very good either. So really, honestly, don't worry about that. How can people get in touch with you, Gabrielle, and find out more?
Yeah, well, if they want to contact me, the website at the minute's been upgraded, so if they contact me by email at doggyeducation@hotmail.com. So it's doggy education@hotmail.com.
Perfect. Thank you so much. And I'm going to say, well, I hope you enjoy the rest of the day, and congratulations on as well on your upcoming new member, new addition to the family. That's very exciting news.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gabrielle. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Okay, people, so that brings us to the end of this show. And our next show will be at the beginning of April, when we're going to have some more absolutely amazing guests joining us. We're going to be joined by Laurie Schlossnagel, and I'm hoping I'm pronouncing that correctly. She's the director and founder of Paws with Compassion. So I'll apologize to her straight away and ask her how to pronounce her name for next time. We're also going to have Diana Nichols on the show, and Diana Nichols-Papert, she'll be talking to us about a presentation at PPG's Force Free Summit. And we will be chatting to Yvette Van Veen, who's an animal behavior consultant and a pet writer and columnist for the Toronto Star. She's going to be joining us actually from Ontario. So we're really looking forward to the next show. Many thanks to Rebecca King for definitely helping me out a lot here. So thank you, Rebecca. Many, many thanks to all our guests. And for not only your great questions, but for taking the time out of your Sunday for coming on the show. Massive thank you to all our wonderful audience for listening in. And I hope you all enjoy the rest of the day. Look forward to joining you again on the next show, when I'll be back with my co-host, Nikki Tudge. So thank you very much, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your day, and bye for now.